Hi everybody, Jameson Malgiri with another Level Inspections. I wanted to make a video about 10 things you could do to prepare for your inspection. So whether we're inspecting a property you're looking to purchase or we're doing a maintenance inspection for your home, there's different things you can do to get the most out of your inspection. So I wanted to go through some of those today and just briefly talk about different things you can do. So the first one is to review and sign your inspection agreement. So the inspection agreement helps us to give you the information about exactly what we're looking to do for your inspection. So what things we want to look at, the limitations of the inspection, and it's very important for us all to be on the same page. So we do ask that you review and sign your inspection agreement prior to the inspection starting. The second thing that we recommend is being present and hopefully engaged during your inspection. So different home inspectors have different approaches. We love for you to be at the inspection. We love to answer questions. We love to go through the home with you at our side and talk about the different findings as we go. There's definitely a detailed report that you would get even if you're not at the inspection. However, it's impossible to really put everything we see during the inspection into the report. So it's better to be there for the inspection and then use the report to reinforce the different things we talked about during the inspection. So that is the general best practice. Another thing that we recommend is asking the seller and any animals in the property to leave for the inspection. So when a seller's present, we're happy to do our job like any other situation. However, it tends to be more efficient when the seller's not there because there's a natural tendency to explain the issues that come up during the inspection, and that kind of slows us down and may reduce the amount we're able to look at during the inspection. Also, some pets can pose a safety concern, so it's better when animals and owners are just not present. That way there's no reasons that come up during the inspection that take away from the time we have or the things that we're able to look at and go over with you. Another thing that's important, we can call this number four of things to do, is tell us anything that should not be tested. And if you don't own the property, this should be a question for the seller. Is there anything that has an issue with it or a safety concern or could cause a problem for you that we should not test? You know, it's common to, for example, trip AFCI and GFCI devices. And, you know, if there's specialty computers or some sort of circumstances like that, it's best to ask the seller about that. Let them know we'll be doing a typical home inspection. If anything shouldn't be done, please let us know prior to the inspection. We also request, number five would be to let us know of any kind of special requirements for the inspection. In some cases, our clients may not want us to talk because there's cameras in the home, or they may not want us to show up early because of a situation with the owner. Or, you know, many other things involved with the different parties where we may want to give you the information a particular way or act a certain way, and we're happy to follow any special instructions like that should we know them prior to the inspection. So just let us know of any particular special kind of circumstances. So the sixth thing is we always recommend dressing appropriately. So if your inspection's on a rainy day, an umbrella is great, a rain jacket's great, the appropriate shoes are great. If it's on a cold day, it's great if you can dress. We do inspect the inside and outside of the building, so it's always best if our clients can join us for as much as possible. So we always recommend kind of wearing the appropriate clothing for whatever the circumstance may be. Another one, particularly for a new construction home, is to make sure all the utilities are on. So the main water to the building, the gas, the propane, whatever it may be, even a heating system being activated or a cooling system being charged, calibrated, installed, all that type of stuff. We just want to make sure whatever is a priority to you is on and activated properly so that we can test it. Now, there's some situations where that equipment might not be safe, so there might be other reasons we don't test it, but you give yourself the best chance by making sure at least things are on, because we're not going to be able to test faucets if we don't have water to the building or the drains from the sinks that those faucets are hooked up to. So trying to eliminate as much of that as possible is definitely a good idea. Another one is clutter. You know, we run into a lot of situations where there's delicate items, large amounts of items, or different situations where we just can't get to certain areas of the building. Making sure as much as possible is cleared out in the building for us to do our inspection, particularly around heating systems or electrical panels or water heaters or where the main water comes into the building, where the waistline leaves. All that stuff is really important parts of the inspection, and with enough clutter it can prevent us from getting into basements, attics, wherever, and completing really the best inspection that we can complete. So moving those items is not something we're always going to be able to do, so asking that it's done in advance is the best kind of practice when it comes to clutter. Also, locked areas. Sometimes there's sheds that are locked or parts of the home that are locked. And we want to inspect those areas in some cases, so we always recommend if you have an area that's locked or an area that's completely obstructed, like maybe a waste pipe in a basement is drywalled over, wherever we need to get to, it's a really good idea to make sure that we can get to all those different systems and everything is unlocked and accessible. On the same note, the last thing, item number 10, is common areas. So we, with a condo building, there might be areas where they take special keys or management or kind of permission to go into certain areas of the building. So a condo roof, a condo electrical room, a boiler room or a heating system or central cooling system or utility area or parking space or any of those different kind of areas, may not fully inspect the areas. However, when we're doing a condo inspection, we like to get in wherever we can get in, and then during the inspection decide if there's anything we need to note as a courtesy to our client in those areas. So the more places we can get into, the better, because sometimes there's valuable information we find in those areas. So those are 10 different items or different things that you can do to make sure you maximize your inspection and to try to get the most out of it as possible. There's some other smaller things that you can do, but in general, those are kind of the big ones. And if there's any other circumstances or questions you have about how to prepare for the inspection, certainly reach out to us at any time. And you can get more information at inspectingyourhome.com. Thank you.